Hello and welcome back to the National Solar Observatory. We're getting ever closer to the total solar eclipse, less than 3 months to go now. We hope you found these webcasts a useful tool in preparing for the solar eclipse. We've tried to cover a whole range of different topics, from storms on the sun, all the way through to the Sun-Earth-Moon system and how solar eclipses happen. Today we're going to be bringing it back home and we're going to be focusing on how the sun affects the Earth and how the Earth is dependent on the sun. Of course, there's some very obvious ways in which we're dependent on the sun. The sun is the source of light that allows us to see our surroundings outside. It's the source of heat that allows us to live comfortably. It's the source of our energy that allows plants to grow and our animals to feed. And more recently, is the source of solar energy, which allows us to power our electronics and it helps to contribute to the electric grid. We're extremely fortunate here on Earth that we are located where we are. If we were on Venus or we were on Mars, we wouldn't be able to survive as a human race. We live in what's called the habitable zone, and this is a region around a star that is just close enough to get sufficient light and heat, but not so close that we are fried or overexposed. We're not too close, we're not too far away, we're just in the middle where it's just right. This is often called the Goldilocks effect. And this Goldilocks zone is something that we look for when we're looking for extrasolar planets. But aside from looking at the distance of a planet from a star, there's other factors that we have to remember to take into account. For example, we spoke in earlier webcasts about solar storms, solar flares, and coronal mass ejections. If there's a planet that's located in the Goldilocks zone, but the star nearby is producing enormous solar flares at a very high frequency, life most likely won't be able to survive there. So solar activity, or in this case, stellar activity, is something that we also have to take into account when looking for extrasolar life. For example, a recently discovered potential Earth-like planet that is orbiting around Proxima Centauri b also has very extreme space weather events. Its local star produces solar flares that are so large that making that Earth 2.0 is really not a viable option. So our dependency on the sun really goes beyond the light and the heat and the things that we need to survive in a positive way. We also have to be aware of some of the challenges of living within the atmosphere of a star. Throughout this webcast series, we've covered some of these ideas already. We've talked about solar storms and coronal mass ejections. Today, we're going to be bringing in an expert from NOAA's Space Weather Prediction Center, who is a space weather forecaster, and he's going to tell us what we should be looking for when we're looking for space weather activity in our atmosphere. But before we get into that detail, I want to bring you back to the Earth again for just a moment. So the Earth's atmosphere is made up of multiple layers, and the outermost layer of the atmosphere is called the ionosphere. So in previous webcasts, we've mentioned the word ion. This is an atom whose electrons have been pulled off by excess energy. So the ionosphere is a literal sphere of ions that's on the outside of our atmosphere. But the ionosphere is not quite spherical. Because it's predominantly caused by emissions coming from the sun, it's much denser on the side closest to the sun, and on the side that's far away from the sun, it's much, much thinner. So the ionosphere is almost like an oval-shaped blob that the Earth rotates inside of. Some of the specific effects that we can predict, although we're not entirely sure for certain, that will happen during the solar eclipse are going to happen in this region of the atmosphere. Since this region occurs as a result of emission from the sun ionizing the outer layers of the Earth atmosphere, that would suggest that when the moon moves in front of the sun, it's going to block some of that ionization effect. So there are some theories that predict there will be waves that are launched in the upper atmosphere during the solar eclipse as a result of changes in this density profile. So essentially, you can think of it as being like a dip in the depth of the ionosphere. Changes in the ionosphere are some of the things that we really watch out for with space weather. For example, when we're using long-wave radio communications, the radio waves are bounced off the ionosphere to get all the way around the globe. This is how we can use them for worldwide communication systems. However, if the density and the thickness of the ionosphere changes as a result of excess solar energy, then the location of those radio waves all of a sudden become uncertain. So the ionosphere is affected by significant changes in the sun's output, and predominantly in this case, as a result of solar flares. So when we get a solar flare, We talked about it being a release, a sudden release of light and energy. And that light and energy causes extra ionization to occur in the Earth's ionosphere. So it's important for us to understand the source of solar flares and how they propagate and the size of them and where on the sun they are occurring so as we can be prepared for any effects that might happen here on Earth. Similarly, coronal mass ejections are another aspect of space weather that we have to pay attention to. Coronal mass ejections, or CMEs for short, are large eruptions of magnetic field and plasma, so highly ionized gases. And these eruptions leave the sun, they erupt from the sun, and they travel through space. And if they happen to be directed towards the Earth, they can interact with the Earth's magnetic field. So if the magnetic field in the coronal mass ejection is oriented in a particular way, it can interact with the Earth's magnetic field. So the Earth's magnetic field looks like a bar magnet that has been dragged out on one side and squished up on the other side. And it has a direction. So the magnetic field runs between the North Pole and the South Pole. Equally, the coronal mass ejection's magnetic field also has a direction. Now, if they happen to be pointing in the same direction, not much happens. This is a bit like taking the two magnets with the same polarity, so a north and a north, for example, and trying to push them together. They don't really do much. However, if you flip one of them around and you have a south pole and a north pole, and you push them together, they're going to try and stick together. Now, if the Earth's magnetic field is pointing one way and the coronal mass ejection's magnetic field is pointing the other way, then as they approach each other, they're going to try and connect or reconnect. And this can cause significant changes in the Earth's magnetosphere. Now, this is nothing to be alarmed. This is actually the reason why we get aurora borealis. So it's actually something that has quite a positive effect. As the Earth's magnetic field gets reconfigured, it gets pushed back towards the night side of the Earth and gets compressed in the inner layers of the magnetic field. This compression causes bursts of energy to be released, which accelerate electrons down the magnetic field lines. And these electrons enter into the Earth's atmosphere at the north and south magnetic poles. As the electrons that are carrying this extra energy approach the north and south poles, they meet this wall of atmosphere. As they hit the atmosphere, the energy that they're carrying gets distributed, it gets released into the atmosphere. And in turn, it excites the atoms that are located in the atmosphere. And those atoms, they release that extra energy by glowing. And that glow is what we see as the aurora. So we see the greens and we see the reds. Sometimes you'll see purple. That's all as a result of emission coming from all the different atoms in the atmosphere. The other piece of space weather that we haven't mentioned much so far is a phenomenon called coronal holes. So far, we've talked a lot about solar flares and coronal mass ejections, and these occur in active regions, which are regions of closed magnetic loops. These are areas where the magnetic field pops out through the surface, loops around, and goes back into the surface of the sun reasonably close by. Coronal holes are regions where the magnetic field comes out through the surface, but it doesn't return back again. It's connected all the way out through space. So this flow of particles leaving the sun and traveling out into space can also be the source of some of our space weather effects. This is especially interesting if we have a region coming from a coronal hole that interacts with a region from a coronal mass ejection. And where those two things interact with each other or overlap each other, that's when we get some of the really, really exciting and interesting space weather effects. Returning to the natural world, the solar eclipse, of course, will be a wonderful time to observe changes in the behavior of animals. Once totality hits, birds think that it's time to go to sleep and you see them starting to nest down for the night. Nocturnal animals think that it's time to come out and hunt and find food. So observing the natural world around you is also a really great way of experiencing the solar eclipse. The GLOBE program is a great way of participating in large-scale studies of this. You can actually measure the temperature of the atmosphere where you are, whether you're on the path of totality or not, and contribute to this nationwide project that will be investigating changes in the temperature and the darkness levels across the whole nation. We really hope that you enjoyed our webcast this month and are starting to realize how all of these different pieces come together in the single field of solar physics. As we get ever closer to the total solar eclipse, it's a great time to get in touch with us with your questions. If you have any questions about content that we've already covered or anything that you would like to see us cover, please get in touch. You can email us at outreach@nso.edu. You can find us on Facebook at www.facebook.com/National Solar Observatory. On Twitter, our Twitter handle is @NatSolarObs, and on Instagram, we're @National Solar Observatory. Don't forget to subscribe so as you get notifications of upcoming webcasts, and we look forward to seeing you again next month.